what's up? I'm actually running for Congress here in Rhode Island, and I'm actually originally from Massachusetts and New Jersey, but the speaker that you're going to hear from is Kenneth Abramowitz, who has been a well-known Republican speaker throughout, you know, the past 8 years. He's worked with every candidate, from presidential candidates to congressional senators.
Speak up, young man, damn it!
He spends around 50 to 60 congressmen and senators every year, and he does the same speech that you're going to hear for them too, in a one-on-one though. And it's about saving Western civilization, about identifying the threats to our nation. I went through it, you know, about 10 times already. Ken actually just came from Rhode Island, where we did a tour of Rhode Island. We gave the speech. I heard Ken give the speech in Vegas to England, to Israel. So Ken is very well known in educating the candidates, especially and understanding what's going on. So right now, Matt's going to pass you a handout so you guys can move along on the slides, and you guys can keep the handout as well too.
I'm old and slow, so bear with me. I'm getting heavy.
So I do appreciate you inviting Ken. Christopher Mader actually was with us at our Congressional Candidates Night, where we had every candidate running for Congress in New England listen to Ken, actually. And Chris came down and supported us and just kind of listened. So Chris asked me if I would bring Ken up to you guys. So I was happy to do it. It's about teamwork. It's about party unity. I work with all your candidates running as well, too. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm happy to introduce Ken Abramowitz.
Thank you very much, Russell, for inviting me here. We're going to have some fun tonight. In about 15 minutes, I'm going to tell you everything that's wrong in the world and how to fix it without blowing everybody up. If I could blow everyone up, I could do it in 2 minutes. But I'm going to give you the 15-minute version of what's wrong and how to fix it. So, does everybody have a copy in front of you? Everyone have a copy? Okay. So, I should mention to you that I'm a professional business analyst in the healthcare industry, and I've been in the healthcare industry, analyzing healthcare, for 35 years, and about 3 years ago, I realized that I was unhappy with my government officials in terms of their analysis of the problem of what was going on, and I volunteered myself to basically spend some time analyzing Western civilization as if it were a company, just my natural abilities and analysis, and I created this speech. And then I decided to keep giving the speech, and so this will be my third year of giving 100 speeches a year. And now about two-thirds of the speeches are one-on-one with senators, congressmen, governors, I do it in 15 minutes. Sometimes I do it in 2 minutes. If the senator only gives me 2 minutes, I'll take the 2 minutes. But we'll spend 15 minutes going through what's wrong, and then we'll talk for another 15 minutes to answer whatever questions you might have. So, the conclusions of the speech are on the cover. I always believe it's best to start off with your conclusions. So, and then I'm going to spend the other 14 minutes explaining how I got to those conclusions. So, just looking at the cover, the key problem is Western civilization's under attack from the inside and outside. So in other words, you have to look at the enemies in the restaurant, so to speak, and then the enemies outside on the street. And the key solution is we need politicians, governments, that can do three things at the same time. Maximize growth in the economy, protect the people intellectually, culturally, and legally, and protect the people physically. It sounds pretty simple. It is, because it is simple. And it's the Ronald Reagan message. I'm just reviving it. But 80% of politicians can't do it. By the way, 100% of Democrats can't do it. And let's say 60% of Republicans can't do it. They can do one issue or two issues, but they can't do three issues. Either because they don't know enough or they don't believe enough. But the way I look at it is the three issues are interrelated. You cannot be wrong on one of the three issues. And if you are wrong on one of the three issues, you'll soon be wrong on the other one or two issues. Okay. So let's go to page two. I believe in my business capacities, when I give speeches, I believe in putting complete thoughts on one page. Because you never can count on people to look at the second page. So this page contains everything wrong in the world on one page. It wasn't easy fitting everything that's wrong in the world on one page, but I did. So, and it's color-coded. So all of you are yellow to represent the sun. Your sunlight, your Western civilization. You believe in the rule of law, the Constitution, the Bill of Rights. You believe in the Bible. Your secular beliefs, your religious beliefs. But you're basically normal. And congratulations, you join the other one-third of the population who's normal.
Thank you very much.
Unfortunately, two-thirds of the people believe in false narratives. One of the reasons we're so exhausted every day when we get home is because we have to spend two-thirds of our time talking to people who believe in false narratives. So there's four major false narratives in the world today, color-coded. So there's the reds, socialists, communists, progressives, leftists, who basically believe that if there's a problem facing you, the government is the solution. In reality, if there's a problem facing you, you're the solution. You have to solve your problem. It's your problem, and you solve it. Your family has a problem, you solve it. You cannot sit at home waiting for someone from the government to knock on the door, and they say, I heard you have a problem, I'm here to help you. That's a false narrative. You'll be long dead before someone knocks on your door volunteering to help you. Then we have the false narrative of the blue, which is the worldwide leftist, socialist, communist, progressives, symbolized by the United Nations, blue is the color for the UN. But the EU, European Union, would also qualify. These are multinational organizations who basically are under the premise that if the United States has a problem or Britain has a problem, the people in Britain or the United States are too stupid to solve their own problems, so the world government will solve it for them. That's a false narrative. If America has a problem, America has to solve its problem. If the UK wants control over immigration, and the EU doesn't want the UK to have control over immigration, the UK should determine its own policy relative to immigration, not wait for some bureaucrats in Brussels to agree or disagree. It's none of their business. Then we have the false narrative of the isolationist, color-coded white, for the surrender flag, who would say, we don't have to worry about any of this stuff. We have oceans. We have prairies. We have mountains. It's a false narrative. If some bad guy wants to get you, they'll swim, they'll fly, they'll figure out how to find you. And then we have the false narrative of political Islam, the politicization of a religion. In particular, I monitor the four worldwide terror organizations, all of whom would agree, as terror literature says, Christians, Jews, and Hindus will convert to Islam or we're going to kill them. That's a false narrative. You can't go around killing people who disagree. For example, I'm a great Republican. If I said, I'm such a great Republican, every time you see a Democrat, kill him. Am I still a great Republican? No, I'm a criminal. I should be in jail. And so I monitor the four worldwide terror organizations. Iran, number one terror organization in the world, pretending to be a government in a country. It's actually a terror organization that took over a country. Number two, Al-Qaeda, ISIS. There's hundreds of names of Al-Qaeda, ISIS-like organizations, but to make it simple, Al-Qaeda, ISIS. Number three, the Muslim Brotherhood, financed by Turkey and Qatar. Number four, Saudi Arabia, Saudi Wahhabis. Saudi Arabia and the Muslim Brotherhood together control most of the mosques in the country. And they're teaching their children a false narrative, as I just mentioned, that Christian Jews and Hindus must convert to Islam or be killed. That's a false narrative. And the first two terror organizations are primarily physical terror organizations. The latter two are primarily intellectual terror organizations. I regard both as terror organizations. To give you an example of the difference between an intellectual terror organization and a physical terror organization, an intellectual terror organization might have an imam say, Christians and Jews are the sons and daughters of apes and pigs. They didn't kill them. Those are just words. Someone listens to the words, takes a knife, and kills somebody. That person with the knife is called a physical terrorist. But my feeling is the person who encouraged that person to pick up a knife under this false narrative is an intellectual terrorist. So I monitor both physical and intellectual terror organizations. So I have this theory that in 10, 20, 50, 100 years, two-thirds of the people will be yellow, not one-third. If we do our job, if we elect leaders who are strong in the belief of growing the economy, protect the culture, protect the citizenry, and do a convincing job re-educating the population, if you look at the two-thirds of the people who believe in false narratives, half of them are not evil. They're just uninformed, misinformed, ill-informed, disinformed. And with the right message and right messenger, we should be able to get half of those two-thirds to become normal. Or at least normal for one day, the one day that they vote. And then we'll have two-thirds of the people yellow. So that's my objective in life, is to help get the yellow pie to be two-thirds of the population, not one-third. Because it's exhausting when it's one-third, because we have to listen to nonsense two-thirds of the time. Let's go to the next page, page three. Now, everybody have a copy, because we have plenty of extra copies. If you don't have a copy, just raise your hand.
Who needs one? Anybody else?
Okay, so we're on page three now. Page three is a little scary, so I apologize for that. But the world around us is a little scary, and it's hard to sugarcoat it. We're now in World War III. We don't know it, but we are. Political Islam's declared war on us on five fronts. They call it civilization jihad. We actually don't have a word for it because we don't know we're in a state of war. If you look at the left of the page, it says political Islam entity, Iran and its friends, Islamic State and its friends, Muslim Brotherhood, and Saudi Wahhabis. Then if you go across the page, you'll see there's five forms of warfare the way I define it. There's physical war, obviously. There's intellectual war. You can fight with words. You don't have to just fight with knives or bullets. There's economic war. You can fight with dollars or cyber. There's legal war. You can fight with lawyers. And there's demographic war. You can move populations around. For example, Turkey ships 1 million Muslims to Germany. That was a declaration of demographic war against Germany. Germany didn't know what hit it. So here we have a situation where the four worldwide political Islam terror organizations have five strategies to destroy the West, and the West does not have one strategy to save itself. I've never seen a strategic mismatch of this magnitude in all my business life. Now, I'm from the healthcare industry, but just pretend that I was from the automobile industry. If I said to the President of General Motors, Mr. President, do you know that you have four competitors? There's Ford, and there's Chrysler, and Toyota, and Honda. He'd go, obviously, I've been president of this company. I know who our competitors are. And you say, and Mr. President, do you know they have five strategies to take market share from General Motors? They have better cars, smaller cars, better performing cars, lower priced cars, and better marketing. You say, of course, and I have strategies too, because I want to gain market share from them. You haven't told me anything new. That's the way it is in the business world. But when you show up, and I show this to senators and congressmen, and I say, the four terror organizations have five strategies to destroy the West. And the West doesn't have one strategy to save itself. They look at me and say, you're right. I say, look, I'm just a little citizen, analyst, citizen. You're the senator. Do something. That's your job. They go, yeah, we have to do something. I say, well, do it. Hello. Okay, next page. Now, I'm going to show you a page on Israel, and then we're going to go to a page on America. The reason why it's important to understand Israel is that Israel's the eastern border of Western civilization. Israel basically protects Western civilization from the barbarians.
Yes.
Israel's been fighting every day since 1948.
Absolutely.
They know how to fight. Actually, if you knew enough history, Jews have been fighting for 3,800 years. So you can't scare a Jew by saying, oh, you're going to have to fight for existence tomorrow. No. Obviously, it's been 3,800 years. Yeah. What did you expect? And so it's illustrative to see, when I show this to Israeli politicians or military folks, they don't have any disagreement. They go, yes, we have a lot of challenges. For example, just going through this quickly. Number one, Israel has to protect itself from Iranian nukes. Number two, Palestinian Authority, low-intensity terrorism. Number four, cyber. Number three, cyber. Number four, ISIS threatening Jordan. Number five, ISIS threatening Egypt. Number six, the Muslim Brotherhood, Hamas, already took over Gaza. Number seven, the Bedouins are stealing all the land they can steal, financed by the Muslim Brotherhood in the EU, unethically. Eight, Israel has to protect its offshore gas fields. Nine, the UN, EU, International Court of Justice, and NGOs they call intellectual terror organizations, but they have a false narrative. And in the north, Iran through its Hezbollah division. So this is a mess, but Israel knows it's a mess. Israel has strategies against each of these 10 fronts. They could have better strategies, I'll say they have perfect strategies, but Israel by and large knows what it's doing. Now let's go to the next page, and in contrast, we'll see a country that has no clue what it's doing. So page five. The United Nations is fighting a war for our existence. We don't even know it. And we're fighting on 10 fronts, we don't know that. And we're losing on every front, we don't even know that. So number one, we have to protect ourselves from Iranian nukes that they're now building to put on top of ICBMs that they're also building with our money. Because we are financing their nuclear program. The United States government is now the number one financier of terror in the world today. Do Americans know that? No. Are the Republicans acquainting the people with that? No. So I don't blame the people for not knowing. I just can't imagine why the Republicans aren't educating the people. Number two, the UN is an enemy of Israel, so also an enemy of America. Why are we housing them in New York? Number three, NATO is underfunded and not capable of defending Europe from either Russia or political Islam. Well, why would you have a national security arrangement and then not give them enough money and soldiers to do their job? So don't have one. I mean, either have one and that works or don't. But we have one that is basically a military name only. Number four, President Obama, sometimes with a Republican help, I must say, is importing European socialism to America. Well, we can't afford European socialism in Europe, we certainly can't afford it in the US. Number five, Iran has a base in Venezuela and is running the largest narco-terror operation in the history of the world, with an estimated 40 to 50,000 agents, either Iranian or Hezbollah Lebanese agents running around Latin America, breaking the Monroe Doctrine. Now someday, when you have time, walk out on the street, any street, interview 10 people, tell them you're a professor of something or other somewhere, and say, I'm doing a survey, can you please tell me about the Monroe Doctrine? And see how many of the 10 have any clue what you're talking about. I'll bet it's 0 out of 10, maybe 1 out of 10. Number six, the Muslim Brotherhood's in jail in Egypt. We allow them to run around in the US. Number seven, 80% of mosques financed by Saudi Wahhabis or Muslim Brotherhood teaching false narrative to their children, who then of course become adults and terrorists, physical terrorists. Number eight, Iran, Al-Qaeda, ISIS just walking across the Indian Ocean, the border's half open. Why would you want a border half open? By the way, I'll digress for 30 seconds and tell you an immigration joke that I created. You're having a party at your house. I knock on the door, with my nine friends, and I said, we'd like to come to your party. Remember me? We met in Worcester, and I heard you have a great party. I want to come. And you say, well, okay, well, who are your nine friends? I said, well, four plus me, five of us, you'll love us. We're just like you. Well, great conversations, you'll love us. Okay, who are the other five? Oh, four of them haven't eaten for 3 weeks. They hear there's a lot of free hamburgers at your house. Mm-hmm. They're not talking to anyone about anything. They're just eating hamburgers. You know, well, okay, maybe. And who's number 10? Oh, number 10 came to kill you. So you say to me, well, who are the five, and who's the four, and who's the one? I go, I don't know.
Great analogy.
100 out of 100 people will close the door, lock the door, and call the police, and say, Mr. Officer, there's 10 people out here, 5 seem very nice, 4 seem like they're freeloaders, and one wants to kill me. Could you please identify the 5 and the 4 and the 1? The 5 can come in, and maybe if I have a lot of hamburgers, the 4 can come in. Obviously, I don't want number 10 to come in. And if you can't determine who are the 5 and who's the 4 and who's the 1, no one's coming. It's just common sense. And if it's common sense for you and your houses, it's common sense for a country.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, number 9. North Korea is developing nukes and sharing the technology with Iran. Number 10, cyber agents from China, Russia, North Korea, and Iran attacking us every second of every day. This is a mess. The next president's walking into 10 OK Corrals and will basically become a war president fighting on these 10 fronts. Let's go to the next page. I want to talk about the Iranian agreement that America reached with Iran, which, by the way, Iran never signed.
Say it again.
I want to discuss the Iranian agreement that America worked out with Iran, which Iran never signed.
Thank you.
But America handed over $150 billion, either in cash or sanctions relief, to the number one worldwide terror organization in the world, thereby providing material support for terrorism. Any Democrat who voted for this deal, which they never signed, lost their right to be reelected for anything, including dog catchers. You cannot have a country like America provide material support for terrorism. It's immoral and unethical. Now let's go down the left column of the page, where it says policy. Sometimes I'm talking with Israelis and they say, oh, President Obama abandoned us. And I showed them this page. I said, well, you know, you have good company. He abandoned Sunni Muslims, just going down the left column. Syria, Lebanon, Iraq, Kurds, Yazidis, Jordan, Yemen, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, UAE, Egypt, Israel, Latin America, the Iranian people, Europe, Christians, Iranian terror victims, Democrats, Congress, and U.S. future generations. I've never, in all my life, seen something more unethical than the Iranian deal. And the Republicans don't explain it to the people, so the people don't know the magnitude. So I have another joke about the Iranian deal. So a terrorist walks into the restaurant and says, I'm going to kill everybody in this room in 60 seconds, unless you give me a lot of money. So we huddle all here. And I say to all of you, I'm a master strategist. I know everything about strategy, vis-a-vis terrorism, and I have this wonderful plan. And you go, oh, okay, what is it? And I said, we have to discuss. We only have 50 seconds left to discuss. So I say, all of you are going to go run at the terrorist. Statistically, he'll kill 3 of you or 5 of you. But because there's so many, it's 30 people here, the other 25 will overwhelm him and gather his gun and call the police. Statistically, 5 of you are going to die. And then you say to me, so what are you going to do? I say, oh, there's a door right behind this flag. I'm going to run out the door and get the hell out of here.
There you go.
So you say to me, well, what kind of plan is that? I say, well, it's a good plan for me. Okay, so this is the Iranian deal. It was a good deal for President Obama, and we're going to be stuck paying for it for the rest of our lives. Okay. Page 7. Just 3 more pages. I'll be finished in 3 minutes, and then we'll take your questions. Page 7. The number one enemy of Western civilization, I call Western civilization. We have to solve our own problem. The number one problem we have internally is socialism, or liberalism, progressivism, there's many leftism, there's many words for it. But here's how it works. Number one, a politician overpromises you, me, it's called liberalism, and keeps doing it, it's called socialism. Number two, the economy slows, the government runs out of money, and it attacks the rich for being greedy, and use it as an excuse to steal money. Number three, the government still runs out of money, and then cuts the military. It's called sequestration, I hate to say it, it was bipartisan. And number four is where we are now. You pretend to the population that the enemy's a no big threat. Remember the JV team? The bad guys get excited and emboldened, and you get yourself into World War III. So basically, our government has gotten us into World War III. We didn't know it, we didn't want it, there's no reason for us to be in World War III. By the way, there was no reason to be in World War II. The Allies should have stopped the Germans in the early 30s, the mid 30s, the late 30s. They did nothing, nothing, nothing. 5 years later, 60 million dead people. For no reason at all. What's going on right now is a repeat of World War II. We're making the same mistakes that our parents or grandparents made then. Let's go to the next page. Page 8. The official debt of the U.S. in 2013 was $17 trillion. The unofficial debt is 10 times that.
Yes.
So I regard the $17 trillion of 2013 as a mortgage. Think of it that way. And I there's nothing wrong with mortgages. I mean, we all need mortgages to buy our house. I think that's fine. But we don't need 10 mortgages to buy a house. And the unofficial debt is, or the unfunded liabilities is the equivalent of having 10 mortgages on your house. You have enough money to pay one of the mortgages, and I say to you, how are you going to pay the other 9 mortgages? Oh, the kids will pay, and the grandkids will pay, and the great-grandkid. And I say, wait a minute, you can't throw that debt onto the great-grandchildren. You say, watch me, I'm doing it. Okay, so in effect, this is intergenerational theft. I hate to say it's bipartisan, but I'll still blame the Democrats. And because the Democrats are the party of Santa Claus. And to compete, the Republicans, I call the party of Santa Claus light. So everyone's a culprit here. But intergenerational theft is basically taxation without representation. Because we're taxing the kids, grandkids, and great-grandkids who either don't vote or don't exist. And it's unethical. What we're doing. Okay, let's go to the last page, page 9, and I'll conclude in 1 minute. Page 9 is just amplification of the cover of my speech. Just look at the bold print. You can read the rest later. As I said in the beginning, we need politicians who can maximize economic growth so we all have more money. Number two, protect people intellectually, culturally, legally. And number three, protect the people physically. It's not complicated. It's actually relatively simple, and our system can't do it. An average Democrat, whenever someone gives a speech, wherever you hear the speech, great, the politician, pretend you're a professor. I do this all the time. The Democrats are consistent. Every time they open their mouth, they get an F and F and an F. Once in a while, they get a D and D and a D, and I say, wow, that's a good Democrat. But in general, 3 F's. Republicans, the average Republican gets a B, a C, and a D. So when I meet with the politicians, I say you should get an A and an A and an A. It's not that difficult. A and an A and an A. So keep your ears open, your eyes open for politicians that deserve an A and an A and an A. And if they don't, and you happen to meet them, pretending in a setting like this, go up to them and say, I don't think your policies relative to whether it's economy, culture, or physical protection are strong enough. And challenge them and encourage them to get an A and an A and an A, because if all Republicans could get an A and an A and an A, and all Democrats, which you can count on them to get an F and F and an F, theoretically the contrast between good and evil will be so wide that the yellows, in other words, we, the rational centrists, will go from one-third to two-thirds of the population, and we won't have to listen to nonsense two-thirds of the time, we'll only have to listen to nonsense one-third of the time. Thank you very much for your time. So, does anyone have some non-nonsense questions?
So, I get from your speech that you're a terrorism expert, yes?
I try to understand the whole... I look at life as a 10,000-piece puzzle.
Okay.
And there's experts who know more than I know about this 100-piece and that 300-piece. But what I do is I take all the pieces and try to look at the impact of everything
so
on everything.
So you looked at it carefully.
Yes, right. So I looked at all the 10,000 pieces.
Because I read and cover up that a lot of ink this year with the 28 pages, and everyone's thinking about 9/11 again, and what does it mean, and who did what. But the thing that gets me thinking back to is on the day itself. I've always wondered, and maybe you know, how did Al-Qaeda get access to that third building, Building 7, to plant the bomb? Because anyone can call up that on their phone right now and see it's a controlled demolition. So how did they get into that building?
Who says it was Al-Qaeda? Who says it was Al-Qaeda?
I didn't say. I don't know. I assume it was, but maybe I'm wrong.
Well, it's a logical question. I don't have a direct answer for you, but I'll go back to something I said. There's four terror organizations. You have to look at all four of them. What were all the four doing? Now, the commission didn't look at all four terror organizations because it didn't know they were in World War III and didn't know that there's four terror organizations and therefore didn't look at each strategy of each of the four. They should have. And so it could have been that, although Al-Qaeda was the principal responsible agent, so to speak, they could have gotten help from Iran. I've heard lots of stories of Iran helping Al-Qaeda. And they could have also gotten some help from some Muslim Brotherhood operatives.
Well, 8 years after 9/11, how could the WTC complex be allowing Muslims to come in unchecked?
Well, this is a tricky issue. There's Muslims, there's Islam, and there's political Islam. There's a difference between the two. As you know, in America, we have freedom of religion. So you have the freedom to be a Muslim, even though we might disagree with that, individuals do have that freedom. What you don't have is the freedom to impose your religion on somebody else. That's what I call political Islam. If someone says, I'm a Muslim, I go, okay, I mean, it's not for me, but that you have the right to be a Muslim. And if someone says, and you have to be a Muslim or I'm going to kill you, I go, no. I'd say, no, that's illegal. That's immoral. That's unethical. You should be in jail. So I happened to hear a Muslim Brotherhood operative who left the Muslim Brotherhood, converted to Christianity to give speeches. And after a speech, I went up to him and I said, if you could go into the Quran, what percent of the Quran is a religion versus a political movement? He said, think of it as roughly 80-20. Think of it as a 20% religion, 80% political movement. We don't know how to segregate the 20 from the 80, but one simple way to segregate the 20 from the 80 is what I just said to you. When someone says, I'm a Muslim, I go, well, okay. When you go to the 80 and say, oh, and now I'm part of a political movement, I'm imposing this on you, I go, no, that should be illegal. We don't know how to declare the 20% legal and declare the 80% illegal. We're going to have to figure it out sometime. So the point you're getting to is really the point I was mentioning in my joke about the party at your house with my 10 friends. How do you know who's the 5 and who's the 4 and who's the 1? I wish I could tell you that I knew how to do that. So the question is, if we don't know how to do that, should we employ no Muslim anywhere? See, it's a tricky issue. So it's not one of those things that's so easy to answer. But we should insist that Muslims and everybody else accept the Constitution and Bill of Rights. That's the law of the land. We don't want someone coming here and say, I believe in Sharia law, and I'm going to switch your Constitution for Sharia law. So I have a joke about that. You go to a basketball game, and you also like soccer, but you go to a basketball game, and you get a few minutes with the coach, and you say, Coach, you can really do much better if your players kick the ball. and say, hey buddy, you know, this is a basketball game, you know, we dribble the ball here. But yeah, but the team would never expect it. They'll be so surprised when we start kicking the ball, you can move the ball much further down the court much faster. And the coach would say to me, look, buddy, sounds like you like soccer. There's a soccer match over there in the other stadium. I think you should go watch the soccer match. I think you came to the wrong stadium. Because basketball, we have rules. And we're not going to change those rules because you happen to like soccer. Well, countries have rules too. It's called Constitution Bill of Rights. We're not going to change the Constitution Bill of Rights unless it's through the amendment process. So we're not going to change it because someone says that I believe it should be a law.
Our own politicians do it every day.
True.
Yeah. Well, the Democrats don't believe in the Constitution Bill of Rights. Political correctness is an infringement of civil rights, of freedom of speech. They're breaking it all the time. So that's why I say the Republicans should keep emphasizing over and over and over again the Constitutional Bill of Rights and then accuse the Democrats of not believing it, but they don't. Yes?
Point of interest, how many people are aware of the mosque that's down on East Mount Street?
Yes, very, yeah.
Would you be surprised to find out, I know a gentleman who knows, a gentleman who dug a foundation for that, and the foundation goes down 5 levels.
Oh, really?
Just thought I'd let you know that.
I worked in a company, they produce a money gram. I work in customer service, and I see all the time transfers from to different countries in the Middle East. And I don't know why the FBI or the agents, they don't come to look the books, no?
Well, thank you for your question. It's worse than you think. However bad you think that it's worse. According to the website, Investigative Project on Terrorism, there's 150 terror cells operating in the U.S. right now, and the FBI is closing none of them down. Why is the FBI closing none of them down? Because the FBI has been penetrated by the terror organizations, and it's not capable of protecting America anymore.
And last week, I have a lady in the early 60s, and she looked very well educated, and she wanted to transfer money to Switzerland. So I opened her account, and there were countries like Saudi Arabia, Sweden, Morocco, another country, and she was sending money to Switzerland to one of the same people in her account who was in Sweden before. So she left her cell phone on the counter because we are, how you say, I was making the application, and she was texting, okay, in little letters, and the word France was in capital words.
So, it's a big problem. I mean, going back to my joke about the house and the party, reframing it for this discussion, I'll just guess, I haven't seen surveys of this. 5 out of 10 Muslims come to America to be Americans, just like our parents, grandparents, great-grandparents. My grandparents came from Lithuania, they didn't speak English. I'm sure they have no idea what the Constitution Bill of Rights, but if you had talked to them 100 years ago at Ellis Island, they would have said, whatever's in the Constitution Bill of Rights, I believe, because I'm coming here to be an American. And whatever that means, that's what I want to be, okay? 4, I'll guess, out of the Muslims are coming to impose Sharia law on America, and 1 is a physical terrorist. But I don't know how to separate the 5 who want to be American from the 4 who want to impose political Islam, Sharia, on America, and the 1 who's the physical terrorist. And so, it's one of those issues that I wish I told you I had the answer to everything. That's a difficult one.
But isn't that part of the game plan There are various words in the Islamic language, or Arabic, Farsi, whatever you want to call it. There's taqiyya, which is the purposeful lying to infidels. You know what I'm talking about, sir.
Yeah.
Jizra, the tax. And then there's it sounds like jizra, but it's hijra. It's the
That's
cultural, it's the, correct me if I'm wrong, it's the immigration to other countries to slowly indoctrinate that country.
Page three.
Yeah, exactly. Why, okay, knowing that we know this, knowing that our governments know this, any prudent person with a brain can look this up, yet it's allowed to continue. It's in your face, it's happening. We see the rapes in Cologne, we saw all this stuff going on in the various streets of Britain, Sweden, everywhere. Oslo's the rape capital. 99% of all rapes in Oslo caused by Muslim immigrants. Knowing that this is in front of our face, why does this keep on happening?
Okay, it's a good question. The word you used, taqiyya, which is purposeful lying to further the cause. Political Islam is not the only user of it. The user of taqiyya is also the leftist, communist, socialist, progressive. So there's actually a marriage, so to speak, or a joint venture, or alliance, between the left and the political Islam. It's called the Red-Green Alliance. And you would say to yourself, what do the Reds have in common with the Greens, such that they would form an alliance like this? Both of them believe in centralized control up here, and then the individual down here. Whereas in Western civilization, the individual's up here, under God, and the government serves the individual. So the left, the Reds and the Green, both agree that individuals are cannon fodder. They have no rights, it doesn't matter. And all the power should be centralized. So my guess is the Reds say we'll form a marriage with the Greens, and when we get in power, we'll kill them. And the Greens are saying we'll form an alliance with the Reds, and when we get in power, we'll kill them. So for right now, they are both dedicated to lying. And the reason why the left, the Reds and the Greens lie and have to lie, because if they told the truth, they'd be in jail. If the Reds said, I want to be president, I want to raise tax rates, steal all your money, and then build a castle for myself and have lots of fun while you live in poverty, people are going to say, ooh, you know, I don't think I'm voting for Hillary. and the Greens would say, we're going to get all this power, we're going to convert Christians, Jews, and Hindus to Islam or kill them, and then take their money, and we'll live in their castles, and then the people will be cannon fodder living in poverty. People would say, I don't want to vote for that person either. So both of those organizations have to perpetuate their false narrative, because they're false narratives. The movements are false narratives, and so they have to perpetuate their false narrative, and that's why they both hate freedom of speech. Because if you can think and speak, you'll say, wait a minute, you can't do that. That breaks the Constitution, Bill of Rights. And they can't allow you to think. Yes.
So I very much like your presentation, and I like your three key solutions. Of course, they're not easy steps. The order of them, obviously, is obviously you put thought in this. And the first thing is maximize growth in the economy. Why did you choose that one first, as opposed to, I would think most people would instinctively say, protect people physically?
Yeah. The reason I use that order, I spent a lot of time thinking about it, is, by the way, those three issues are equally important. So it's not like I think one's more important than the other. They're equally important, but if you're enumerating one, two, and three, someone has to be one, and someone has to be two, and someone has to be three.
Sure.
So the reason I picked number one first is, by the way, each of these touch a different part of your body. So economic security or prosperity hits your pocketbook. And people being people, we want more money in our pockets than less money. So I figure that's what people are looking for the most. Number two, I put cultural security. And that hits your brain or your heart, however you want to look at it. And then physical protection is really your whole body, plus the kids, the grandkids, the house, and everything else. And so they're all equally important. I just figured I'd go for the pocketbook first, I'd go for the brain and the heart second, and then I'd go for the overall body third. That's how I'm. Yes.
This is really, there's two solutions. That's a great picture. And you've gone into great detail in defining the problem areas. But this, this doesn't look like a solution to me.
Well, I gave you the structure of the solution. Think of it as half of the pie. Half of the pie is having politicians say, I'm going to grow the economy, protect the culture, protect this business. That's only half the story. Mm-hmm. The other half is, well, where are your policies? What policies do you have to grow the economy? What policies to protect the culture and to protect us physically? And that'll be a whole other speech. But I just summarized it quickly on page 9 with the best thoughts that I have for each of them. And I say to politicians, I say, read page 9. If you have a better idea to grow an economy or protect the culture, protect us physically, you put that in instead. And so just like I think about it all the time, you should think about it all the time. And if you have a brighter idea for either of those three issues, keep it in your head. You talk to your politicians. You're welcome to email me. I give you my email address here. And I have a website, Save the West. By the way, you should all subscribe. It's free. I do it as a public service. And but use your head, our heads, and think of better ideas. But we have to talk to our politicians about it. But I focus on getting them onto the structure, because each politician is different. They represent a different group of people in a different part of the country who have different behaviors and thought patterns. And it's really up to them to tailor these three issues to their audience. But I try to give them the structure, the three-legged stool, or the Ronald Reagan message on which they should hang their particular policies of how to solve these three problems. Yes?
Let me ask you a question just to get the answer out here from your lips. What exactly were we looking for with the transfer of $400 million of our currency?
Yeah, the 400 million is the tip of the iceberg. The 400 million was a bribe, but so was the 1.7 billion that it was part of, and behind it, so was the 150 billion. Think of Neville Chamberlain, World War II. He basically signed the Bologna Agreement with Germany, which led to World War II, which led to 60 million bribes. What if I told you Neville Chamberlain also gave $150 billion to Hitler, figuring that the Bologna Agreement plus the 150 would buy Hitler, would appease him? Okay? So it would be even more horrifying than what happened. So the whole 150 billion, of which 400 billion is a lot of money, but it's a small piece of 150 billion, all of it was a bribe for appeasing a terror organization. And I believe that most Americans believe they should not negotiate with terrorists. Even the State Department calls them the number one state sponsor of terror. So the whole deal never should have been done. That's not how you negotiate with terrorists. And in my mind, the whole deal was illegal, not just the 400 million. The whole thing was a bribe.
But don't they also see this bribe, these deals, these negotiations that we make? They see it as a form of weakness on the West. Because Islam is one of those ideologies, cults, religions, whatever you want to call it, based on strength. They only understand war, hate, death, kill, strength. So anytime they have an enemy or even somebody they're conquering, and that person starts negotiating or paying them off, that person is not seen as strong and formidable an enemy. They're seen as weak. Am I wrong on that?
No, you're 100% right. And what it does, it just emboldens the bad guys.
Thank you.
And then you have to fight them again in another way, another time. And we the people get stuck with the mess.
Thank you.
President Obama will go around the country and the world giving speeches for a lot of money, but we're stuck cleaning up the mess.
Thank you.
that's exactly why you should negotiate with terrorists. Yes. Yes.
What motivates the governments and the politicians? And I always go with follow the money. Follow the money. War is profitable.
We're living in a dystopia.
War is profitable. Like Stanley Butler said, war is racket. War is racket. Now, in the example of Afghanistan, by the mid-20th century, Afghanistan had a very free society. Under the king, they had women, equal rights for women. Women wore miniskirts as well as traditional dress. They were getting educated as doctors and lawyers, etc. And then Russia attacked, and Russia came in. Well, then you had a million Afghans escaping into Pakistan in refugee camps. They were of all classes, wealthy, middle class, and poor, and they wanted to educate their children. Who comes to the rescue to educate their children in those refugee camps in Pakistan? A collusion of the CIA, the ISI, and Saudi Arabia. And they created extreme Muslim, because they wanted freedom fighters, quote unquote. They taught them extreme violent Muslimism. Follow the money.
Yes, sir.
Sure. We shipped all this money to Iran, and then we ship a lot of planes to Saudi Arabia and all the other neighboring countries to protect themselves from the Iranian missiles that we're financing. So you say to yourself, is this logical? And so, I divide that people up into two groups, 90 and 10. 90% are stupid and naive, 10% are smart and evil. So whenever someone does something bad, I always say, are they one of the 90 or one of the 10? And then I go try to have it decided in my mind. But it's not great having either of them. Let's see, who else had a question?
Do you have a question back here?
Okay.
My name is Asiya from Pakistan. So I have a question. The war is everywhere. Okay. So why is all Muslim coming refugee? Why? Why is the Christian coming? Because Christian have a lot of problems. Pakistan Christian, all the way have a problem. You see the one of lady, she's in a jail. Many years. She have two kids, and her husband is disappeared somewhere. So she is in the jail. Many Christian refugees, Sri Lanka, Thailand, and many places. Why they don't come over here? They don't come. America never go to the house over there.
Yeah, she makes a great point. Why do we do that?
Yeah.
I mean, we have Hillary had said herself that she wants to increase it by 550%. Why is it always the Muslims? What's happening to the Christians who are actually being slaughtered over here? Where are they? What's happening?
Because it diametrically opposed to Hillary.
Now,
the
Christians are the Muslims are the ones who are coming.
But that's my question, and to buttress what you said, why? What? Where are the? What's
problem
happening?
Problem, reaction, solution.
Go ahead, finish your question.
So right now, somebody sent me my Facebook message. Sister, I am in danger, and my village is Christian. That is very, very dangerous. Can you do something for me over there? So, you know, I don't know anyone. Because everybody bring to the Arabic here, all Muslim here, take a social security, take all advantage, and they still, America is bad, America is this, America always swearing at America. I have no idea.
The number one persecuted minority in the world today is Christians. Christians are getting killed all over the place. Now, by the way, Jews have gotten killed all over the place, but Jews have gotten killed all over the place for 3,800 years. So what else is new? But in the last 10 years in particular, Christians are the most persecuted minority. You wouldn't know that by reading any normal newspaper watching any normal TV news program, listening to any normal politician. So there's a scandal going on out there, and I keep waiting for the Christian community to say, hey, wait a minute, what is our government doing to protect Christians worldwide? One of the biggest signs of decadence of Western civilization was when those 250 girls were kidnapped in Nigeria a couple of years ago. There was this picture of them. They were Christians like 5 minutes before, and then they became Muslims 5 minutes later. And this was a declaration of war against Western civilization. And Western civilization failed. 250 girls in Nigeria, they look different than we look, doesn't matter. The U.S. government should have had Marines and Air Force. If the Nigerian government's not looking for them, the U.S.
The U.N. should have been there.
Right.
Where's the goddamn U.N. been throughout this whole Syrian migrants?
Well, the U.N.'s part of the problem, because the U.N. has been taken over by the Muslim terror organization. So the U.N. actually has to be closed and replaced by the United Nations of Democracies. But these 250 girls should have been saved. If no one else is going to do it, the U.S. government should have done it. And what did they do? Hashtag the girls in Nigeria.
Yeah.
Okay. And did the Republicans criticize the Democrats? No. So, yeah. So we have two problems here. We have an out-of-control Democratic Party, and we have a Republican Party that's not punching enough. I don't mean physically punching, I mean intellectually punching against. Yes?
You know, a lot of your mainstream Christian churches have become apostate. The one I grew up in on Wednesday evenings now teach New Age. Your Southern Democratic, your Southern Baptist Conference down there is now saying to divest themselves from Israel. And I don't know why the Evangelical Society has not responded, except to possibly because of their IRS.
She'll be back next month.
Right. Look, this goes back to the issue that I started with. You have to be economic and strong, and then we go to culture. There's two elements to the culture that have to be maintained. One is our belief in constitutional Bill of Rights, which the Democrats, half the population, no longer believe in. And the other is our belief in the Bible, Judeo-Christian, history, philosophy, tradition, religion.
Yes.
We have to, those are the two pillars holding up Western civilization. Those are the two pillars that made Western civilization in general, and America in particular, the most powerful, industrious, healthy country in the world. And those pillars are weakening. And they're weakening from the Democrats, who no longer believe in either of them, and the Republicans that are not doing their job to make sure that those two pillars are strong.
That's right.
Okay, so there's a double problem. So I try to help help Republicans be strong on those pillars to compensate for the weaknesses inherent in the Democratic Party. Which is, by the way, no longer the Democratic Party. It's the Socialist Workers Party.
Yeah, they have it, yeah.
They just kept the name Democratic Party, so that it looks like they're normal. There's nothing normal.
Thank you, Saul Alinsky.
In the Democratic Party anymore.
Yes.
Okay, anybody else?
I think there's a huge separation in the church, too. The church is not united at all. And the church is very entertained in being mega churches and money and prosperity, and they're very political too. They're getting very involved in politics, but actually in the wrong
politics. First, they should not be in politics, and second of all, they're involved in the wrong politics.
Yeah, and I think that's what really affected the why the Christians are not Christians here, because The Christians here are very involved in other stuff and so entertained with money and stuff that is being thrown to them from the government, because they want them entertained, they want to shut their mouth.
Yeah.
You know, they don't want them to stand up and fight and request, things to happen.
Well, the way I look at it is people have a choice of two gods, so to speak, in life. One is the real God, which we can't exactly put in a box, but we all have different concepts of what the real God is like. And that's the inspiration behind Western civilization. The concept of good and evil, of right and wrong, and human beings acting, but under guidance of their God or conscience, however you want to look at it. And what the people who don't believe in God, and when they look for a second God or a replacement of God, in the Bible, it was the golden calf. In the olden days, people used idols as a alternative to a God that you can't see. Well, nowadays, we don't use idols for the government, and it's become the alternative God. So, for example, for most Democrats, the government is God. God doesn't exist. I have a joke, when was the last time you got a subsidy check and signed God? You can get a subsidy check signed the state of Massachusetts or U.S. Treasury. I've never seen the subsidy of Social Security, God. Okay? So the Democrats have taken the golden calf, modernized it, and called it the government as the new God. The Republicans still have the real God as the real God, and that's a conflict. I mean, they cut the country in half. We almost have two countries. We almost have a civil war going, but it's not a civil war of the 1850s.
Yes.
We're not fighting each other physically. We learned our lesson, or our great-great-grandparents learned their lesson, but we're fighting intellectually. We have an intellectual civil war. We almost have two countries. In this country, and it's sad to see that. It shouldn't be that way. Yes?
What you described about when people had a higher authority to which they went for truth and right and wrong was everything that happened up until the age of reason. When that happened, the modern world began, the authority is then science or human reason. But what we're in now is the postmodern world where there is no authority. What I believe is right, what you believe is right, you can't tell me what's right. You can't tell that person that he can't be a woman. All of this nonsense, and all the things we're talking about now, all of this stem from postmodernist, and it's a philosophy that some people brought up from 100 years ago, and it's been filtered through our school systems and our education system. We all think like this right now. Even though we don't think we do, we are all postmodern thinkers. But when you start to read about what postmodernism postulates and what it does and what it makes words fluid. That's why you can say he thinks he's a woman or whatever. Words are oppressive and all of that. All postmodernism. Yeah. Don't know anything about it. Read a good book. Go on Amazon. Read some viewpoints on postmodernist thought and just read and digest it. It's a damning thing that we're living through. And that's what's everything we talk about, everything. I mean, I think you know about this.
Yeah. Well, we've lost faith in our own beliefs, the constitutional rule of rights and our religious beliefs. And so we already have half the people who have jumped to the other side. So I call Democrats a disease rather than a party for that reason.
Liberalism, certainly.
Yeah. Yes.
I just want to make a couple comments. There were a lot of people were basically, I think, trying to figure out why the government is doing what it's doing and why. I mean, as an example, as I was driving to Framingham tonight, Fox News was doing a very interesting comparison. I went back to the first year of the Obama administration and played multiple times what he said about a certain thing, and then played the reality to show that there's a pattern of lying throughout his administration and how it just keeps him, like today, they finally admitted that they paid the $400 million as a ransom. And if you really look back at Barack Obama, first of all, does anybody in the room know who the Saudi Arabians paid $26.5 million to get into Harvard? It was Barack Obama.
Yeah.
They paid $26.5 million to put him into Harvard. Well, the next question should be, why? Okay? And if you look at the Quran, if your father's a Muslim, you're a Muslim. So we see a pattern here? Okay? And I don't care what he says or what the Democrat Party says, he's a Muslim. And this is why so many things are happening today.
That's why all Muslims are here.
Right. And, when you look at Hillary, When you look at the woman that she claims to be her second daughter, that woman is married to Wiener. We all know who Mr. Wiener is, and God, there couldn't be a more appropriate name for a paper. Now, Wiener, you get what I'm talking about. Okay. So, why would a woman whose mother, father, brother, and sister are high ups in the Muslim Brotherhood marry to a Jew who's also a whack job, you know, who does all these things? Well, because it's okay in the Quran to lie to further the Muslim, you know, beliefs. Do what you have to do, exactly. So when you look at Hillary, this is what scares me so much about when people say, well, they can't vote for Trump for one reason or another. And I'm not really a total fan of the guy, but I know who I don't want in the White House, and it's Hillary. Because it's going to be more of Barack Obama, because she's already in debt with the Middle East and the Muslims.
And women are vicious.
And how far? Well, never mind the origin.
I just wanted to disagree, actually.
Did you say you had to leave early?
No. I disagree about the violence statement. I see. Well, no, it's not in here.
Okay, sorry.
But I see a repeated or a pattern being established that certain types of violence are constantly excused, if not condemned, if they're perpetrated against certain groups.
Yeah.
Like the question, every time there's ever a police shooting, you know, well, was this person justified? Were they put upon? It's a knee-jerk reaction, certain segments of the country to justify, excuse it, explain it away. And other types of even words, not violence, are instantly put upon and condemned. This double standard is reached the level of justifying violence. So
no, what you said is a scandal. You're right. And but there's two scandals here. There's the scandal of the two-thirds, for the people who believe in false narratives. Remember the four false narratives? That's scandalous, that two-thirds of the people believe in false narratives. That's one scandal. The other scandal is, what the hell are the one-third doing, surrounded by these two-thirds false narratives, without doing a better job fighting, and I don't mean physical fighting, intellectual fighting, against the four false narratives? And that's why I call the number one enemy of Western civilization, Western civilization. Because we, the yellows, the light, the sunlight of Western civilization, we're not doing our job.
The sound majority?
Yes, to fight against the four false narratives. And that's one of the reasons I'm here, to energize all of us to do a better job educating ourselves, educating our friends, our relatives, our children, and fighting harder against the four false narratives. I guess the last question.
Last question.
All right, while we're disagreeing, and I'm not leaving early, protect the people physically. This is one of the things that you're saying government needs to do. On LeBron Paul, he says we consented to be governed not for them to keep us safe, for them to defend our liberty. So when I look at, even back in the 80s, there was a church commission that discovered all the trillions of dollars being wasted by the Pentagon, by far the most wasteful department in the government. They lose literally trillions of dollars a quarter. Okay, that kills our freedom right there, all that waste. So I want to go back to the Second Amendment for self-defense.
Yeah.
And if they just get the heck out of our houses, I had a friend who just got arrested and had everything he had taken from him. We've got to start respecting the Second Amendment, and that's how we remain a free and
safe. That's the original Homeland Security.
Let me just respond in 30 seconds. Yes, what you said is correct, but we still need a government to do, someone's got to blow up the Iranian nuclear sites. We're not going to send 1,000 people with guns.
Well, let Israel do it. They did it to Iraq, didn't they?
Sure, but Israel's a little teeny tiny country.
They got nukes?
Iran has promised to kill everyone in America. It's America's job.
They got nukes. Why do they need ours?
Our freedom requires it. Look. Our freedom requires that those Iranian nukes be blown up.
They took out Iraq's.
What do you mean? That doesn't matter.
They blew up the Iraq.
It's irrelevant.
You're forgetting the timeline.
That's a function of government. You're this overseas, just like Jefferson did against the pirates.
You're also negating the timeline. You're talking a different timeline. That was back in the 80s. Different technology, different warfare, different strategies. We're in 2016 now. It'd be very difficult unless they... And generals in the Israeli Air Force have said, unless we strip down an F-16 to make it a flying gas tank, that's the only way they're going to be able to fly into Iran, bomb a facility, and then fly back. It's up to us.
Are you kidding with all of our technology? Are you joking?
This is where it's
a... You know what a drone is, right?
I understand that, but what I'm saying is it's a different type of technology now. It is up to us. Yeah. It is up to us to not only protect our allies.
Two thoughts. After Pearl Harbor, FDR did not say this is a day of infamy. I'm outraged what Japan did, and Canada, go blow up Japan.
Roosevelt knew it was coming.
Okay, but it was America's responsibility to blow up Japan, not to hand it to
somebody
Canada.
Else.
Wasn't a surprise.
Iran has promised to kill everyone in America, death to America.
Those 2,000 men were sacrificed.
It's America's responsibility to blow up Iranian nuclear sites before they blow up us. That's one issue. I want to mention the second
issue. You guys are pacifists. That's not anti-American.
No, I'm a historian.
It's anti-American.
I'm a historian.
It's anti-American. The country's business is protected. You're telling me.
I love it.
One of the greatest gifts we have is the government to protect us. And you're trying to steal it from us.
Not at all. I want
no, to. No, you're on pause. You've got to stop that. All right. Now, I think we'll end here.
That was great.
Now.